Right now, the UN exists only because sovereign governments who are accountable to their people in some way contribute money and are willing to go along with what the UN does. And possibly some countries could say, no, we're not going to do that, and they'd get away with it today. But if the UN were able to raise its own money, raise its own revenues, nobody could stand up against their will. They'd have the power to enforce their will even against a sovereign nation, even against the United States.
The Clinton administration is moving rapidly to transform all these treaties and conferences into U.S. policies, even when we haven't ratified the treaties and haven't agreed to the so-called consensus produced by the UN conferences. The Clinton administration is moving very fast to transfer control over American lands, rivers, resources, private property, and precious heritage sites to the United Nations. And on top of all that, the Clinton administration is determined to put American servicemen and women under foreign command, where instead of defending American national interests, they will be used to fight never-ending UN and NATO wars.
San Francisco, 1945. International leaders gather from all over the world to meet for the first United Nations conference. The organizing secretary general for the San Francisco conference was Alger Hiss, who was later exposed as a Soviet spy. High hopes for the United Nations in the 1940s gave way to disillusionment in the 1950s, when the UN police action in Korea taught us the tragic meaning of the phrase, no-win war. By the 1970s, the UN had become a forum for a steady stream of speeches attacking the United States. When Ronald Reagan was elected in 1980, the anti-American agenda of the UN was finally challenged, and the United Nations lost most of its influence.
Reagan saw the UN really as acting very much against American interests. That it was being used by the Soviet Union, it was being used by a very radical third world majority that called itself the Group of 77. So he felt that the UN had to be dealt with very strongly. That's why he appointed Jeane Kirkpatrick, for example, somebody who, in his view, would go to the United Nations and take down that kick me sign off the United States. That would say, we're going to stand up for American interests, and that means opposing the UN when we need to. It means vetoing things when we need to. It means walking out of conferences when we need to. It means defunding organizations when we need to, UNESCO, for example. So he took a very tough stand. I mean, he was willing to have the United States participate, but his view was, we've got to transform the way we're there.
But then President George Bush revived it in order to make it a sponsor of his Persian Gulf War. Bush introduced a new phrase to the American public.
Out of these troubled times, our fifth objective, a new world order, can emerge. Now we can see a new world coming into view. A world in which there is the very real prospect of a new world order.
President Bill Clinton was glad to define this new world order by demanding ratification of all the UN treaties that Presidents Reagan and Bush had rejected. The Clinton administration is pushing hard for the biodiversity and climate change treaties, for the Law of the Sea Treaty, and for the UN Treaty on Women, and for the UN Treaty on the Rights of the Child. And the global governance advocates of the Clinton administration are also demanding a new and controversial role for America's armed services.
Somehow I don't feel that President Clinton distinguishes in quite the same way that President Reagan did between the United States and the United Nations. I think President Reagan had a very strong sense of American identity and of American citizenship. And I think he was very deeply attached to the American tradition and, you know, to American men and women, but to American freedom and to American forces. And I feel really that President Clinton is much more likely to be speaking about the world. Now, I'm in favor of, you know, the world, too, and I think President Reagan was. But I don't think President Reagan wanted to risk other people's lives. He didn't want to risk American servicemen's lives in, you know, UN berets for causes that had only an ambiguous or remote relationship to American interests.
In May of 1994, Bill Clinton signed Presidential Decision Directive 25. This changed the mission and purpose of America's armed forces.
PDD 25 authorizes the president to deploy U.S. forces into conflict without the consent of the Congress. That bothers me a lot because our Constitution requires that a declaration of war requires the consent of the Congress. Two, I'm bothered by the fact that it permits that U.S. troops may be deployed under U.N. command. What makes U.N. command so very dangerous is that it would put U.S. forces under commanders and with other groups with whom they, you know, are not familiar, with whom they have never exercised, whose language they do not speak, and who do not know them and don't know what they can do and what they can't do. So I think that the capacity for damage and the danger is really magnified under any kind of operation that takes place under U.N. command.
Witness Somalia. Under PDD 25, American troops were sent into that country's civil war under foreign command as so-called U.N. peacekeepers. American forces were ambushed, leaving 18 American soldiers killed, plus 54 wounded. On television that evening, Americans saw Somalians dancing on jeeps and dragging a dead American serviceman through the streets.
Our Rangers should not have been in the streets of Mogadishu unless we had complete operational control.
U.S. forces were not sufficiently heavily armed. They had asked for their commanders, their American commanders, had asked for heavier armor and heavier weapons, and they had been turned down under the peacekeeping policies that were formulated by the same people that formulated PDD 25.
Parents of two of the slain American soldiers spoke to a Senate subcommittee.
I told the president today that Casey did die in vain.
My son's death served no purpose. His courage and sacrifice have been wasted.
When Al Gore, our vice president, tells the parents of the young men who were shot down in that friendly fire helicopter accident over Iraq, "You should be proud of your son who died as a UN soldier." That was a wake-up call to a lot of Americans.
As a congresswoman, it bothers me because most young men and women who sign up for service in the United States Armed Forces pledge to give their all, their life, their liberty, their pursuit of happiness. They lay everything they have on the line to serve America. But most young men and women wouldn't lay everything they have on the line to serve another nation.
Army Specialist Michael New is a decorated American soldier with an exemplary record of service. On October 2, 1995, Michael New's Army commanders informed him that he would soon be ordered to Macedonia as part of a UN peacekeeping operation. But unlike previous U.S. involvement in UN exercises, this mission would be different.
When we fought in Korea, we fought there as U.S. soldiers, side by side with soldiers from other countries, in pursuit of a UN goal, with the understanding that we also had a vital national interest that was being pursued there. When our soldiers go to Macedonia, they go there, in effect, as UN soldiers. They wear the UN insignia. They give up their Department of Defense, their DOD identification card.
This is the first time in history where we've had all the combination of factors of UN foreign commanders, UN uniforms, and clear direction to stop being exclusive a United States soldier. Taking the UN identity card, for example, into Macedonia was one of the requirements.